Good day, everyone. Complaining Gamer here. I thought we could take a look at AMD's top consumer desktop CPU, the 2700X, and how it currently performs in RPCS3, a PlayStation 3 emulator. If you've ever seen any of my previous coverage on RPCS3, I should remind you that those experiences were had using an Intel i5-6400, a 4-core, 4-thread CPU with a base clock of 2.7 GHz. Released in Q3 2015, and a chip which I still think is fantastic. However, when it comes to the processing demands of RPCS3, it simply doesn't cut it. My new system, which you can find detailed in the description below, really is a workhorse, with the AMD Ryzen 7 2700X as the driving force behind it, an 8-core, 16-thread CPU with a base clock of 3.7 GHz and a boost of 4.3 GHz. I think you'll agree it's a tad different to the i5-6400. What this change in hardware means is that my ability to present emulators closer to their full potential has risen exponentially, with some caveats that we'll discuss. The background gameplay is taken from Fear 2 Project Origin, both the demo and full game. Honestly, there's no specific reason why I chose this game, I simply had it to hand and ran it. The interesting thing for me, however, is that I distinctly remember finding the demo pretty much unplayable many months ago on the i5-6400, providing a visually broken slideshow. Slowly but surely, the RPCS3 experience is improving for quad-core users, but a 4-core, 4-thread CPU is always going to be limited in what it can achieve within the power-hungry emulator. Now, with a mixture of significant improvements made to the emulator since I last covered it, and more suitable hardware on my end, the change in playability and experience is night and day, with the FPS seemingly happy to sit around 44 frames per second in Fear 2. If you find the choice in game strange, don't worry about it. There's plenty of time to test multiple titles moving forward, so feel free to make requests. Before we continue, I have a community question I need all of you to answer. So here's the question. When a game is multi-platform and already exists on PC, should it receive less attention from an emulator developer? RPCS3 is currently on alpha build 7786 as of the making of this video. The reason that's important is because each minute in the world of emulation is a snapshot in time of where progress currently is and was, as improvements are always being made. So any coverage done is relevant to when it was created. Alpha often refers to software in its first stage of development, and this is where RPCS3 currently sits, meaning that bugs, issues, glitches, and problems in general are to be expected, and is mostly suited to enthusiasts, not the mainstream yet. With that said, the emulator, even in its alpha state, has achieved many milestones, with a current game playability and compatibility percentage of 37.35 across the PS3 catalog, which can be properly played from start to finish, with a further 45% considered in-game with glitches. The hardware demands of RPCS3 mean that ideally a minimum of a 6-core CPU is used for acceptable levels of playability, with quad cores performing well under specific circumstances and with the right game. It may never come, but personally, I'd love to see a time when the majority of users can enjoy their favorite PS3 games on PC with all of the benefits and enhancements an emulator can provide. Even though I now have a powerhouse of a processor, I know the challenges of experimenting with a low-clocked quad-core and the potential frustrations that brings. Due to the unique complexity of the PS3's cell architecture and the mind-bending challenges emulating it must create, many consider a PS3 emulator even existing a miracle, but exist it does. It's here, it's free, and if you have the hardware, you can participate and enjoy its development. The 12nm 2700X is based on the Zen Plus architecture, and was improved upon since Ryzen's initial launch with its first generation back in February 2017, which used the Zen architecture and a larger 14nm process. With Ryzen, AMD has really blown the doors off the processor market, offering unparalleled price to performance. This is where things start to get interesting, however. RPCS3 loves as much raw clock speed in cores you can throw at it to a point. Does it utilize all 8 cores and 16 threads of the 2700X when emulating? The answer is no, and it may never will. As far as I know, the reason for this, or the limiting factor, is the architecture of the PS3 and the requirements of accurate emulation. The result is untapped potential of a CPU like the 2700X. The Wii U emulator Semu also has architectural limitations, which leaves many threads untouched. Realistically, RPCS3 utilizes around 9 of the possible 16 threads, which would cover 6 SPUs, 2 PPUs, and 1 RSX. And the real-time workload comes out at around 50% utilization on an intense game like God of War 3, but is lower in other titles. What RPCS3 really responds to is raw clock speed and brute force power. This is why a processor like the 8700K and its overclocking headroom really has an edge in RPCS3 over the 2700X. Where the Ryzen CPU shines is in its multi-threaded performance, but there is still more to be done by program developers in general to make use of all of those cores and threads. In the area of multi-threading, AMD Ryzen uses SMT, with the Intel equivalent being hyper-threading. SMT being slightly faster in certain scenarios. Now, the technical nuance and knowledge required for emulated development is far from my area of expertise, so if I misspeak, please say so. Highly skilled developer Mary pointed out to me Amdahl's law used in computer architecture, and also introduced me to the word parallelize. In short, it is not always possible to utilize multiple cores. The ability to use multiple cores depends on the task being able to be parallelized. Some tasks are inherently unable to be parallelized or are difficult to do so. Quite a lot of emulation tasks need to be serialized, meaning one by one as opposed to shared between multiple processing units. As a self-confessed layman, Amdahl's law is just about digestible for me. It's often used in parallel computing to predict the theoretical speedup when using multiple processors. For example, if a program needs 20 hours using a single processor core, and a particular part of the program which takes 1 hour to execute cannot be parallelized, while the remaining 19 hours of execution time can be parallelized, then regardless of how many processors are devoted to a parallelized execution of this program, the minimum execution time cannot be less than that critical 1 hour. Hence, the theoretical speedup is limited to at most 20 times. For this reason, parallel computing with many processors is useful only for highly parallelizable programs. So it strikes me as an all or nothing rule where one link can break the potential maximum performance chain. And when we apply it to the complex nature of emulation, the challenge for developers starts to become a lot clearer. Hopefully that made sense. Moving forward, 2nd Gen Ryzen has done a lot to decrease the gap between Intel and AMD IPC, to the point where many consider it a negligible number nowadays. On the flip side, we have maximum clock speed and single core performance, which Intel still lead in. Price to performance, AMD demolishes Intel, but for raw output, setting aside price, there is a performance percentage difference between the two vendors when allowing for an overclock. CPU user benchmark puts the effective speed difference between the 2700X and the 8700K at 7%. And if we jump to the 9900K, Intel's 8-core 16-thread offering, that difference becomes 20%. The question is, would you pay close to double the price of the 2700X for a 20% performance gain? To me, it's a no-brainer. Factor in the cost of the required components, such as an additional cooler and motherboard, and things really start to become untenable. Whilst the Wraith Prism cooler provided with the 2700X is fine, it's not great, but it's still included out of the box, ready for you to use at no extra cost. On top of that, and perhaps most importantly, the AM4 socket and X470 chipset of the 2700X is going to be supported for further generations, meaning that you can simply swap out a 2700X for a 3700X on your existing motherboard. You don't see this from Intel. The excitement starts to build further when you consider that this is where we sit right now, and with a huge elephant in the room in the form of Zen 2 coming later this year. Reportedly promising improved clock speed, IPC, core count, and single core performance, equivalent to or greater than Intel, along with a 7-nanometer process at the same power draw as Ryzen 2, it literally sets my loins on fire and opens up AMD to truly make their mark on the industry this year, and perhaps cause some Intel devotees to switch over. Early sandbag benchmarks of Ryzen 3000 have got people excited, but there is still an element of speculation to all this until we learn more details. Regarding the 8700K versus 2700X and the underutilized threads, the Ryzen will likely remain the underdog in terms of performance in RPCS3. The 8700K's ability to overclock far beyond the AMD part gives it the edge, and RPCS3 just soaks up every ounce you throw at it within its limits. In that sense, the 2700X is always at a disadvantage here. When the 8700K is not extremely overclocked but left stock and allowed to boost as designed, the performance gap between the two processors diminishes greatly. It is essential that I provide context to the argument. My point of reference is from an idealistic, somewhat extreme silicon lottery perspective. I'm referencing the official RPCS3 presentation demos, which use an 8700K overclocked at 5.3 GHz, which can help make the emulator shine at its fullest potential using a CPU far beyond its stock max turbo frequency. So what if the Intel CPU wasn't overclocked, presumably using substantial aftermarket cooling, and was left stock? The numbers would of course be considerably different. Performance optimizations are constantly being made with RPCS3, and there are some things which benefit AMD and some which benefit Intel. For example, Thread Scheduler for Ryzen and the benefits of TSX for Intel. The 2700X truly shines as a very significant time saver when compiling and loading modules and shaders, a crucial part of using RPCS3, such as when you first install a game and the subsequent loads of any given title. The compiling and loading of modules and shaders is a particularly intense process which the Ryzen just eats up, and RPCS3 in this instance does utilize every core and thread 100%, leading to rapid boot times of games, whether new or established. Trust me when I say it's quite the eye-opener seeing 16 threads slammed to the wall. What this means is that testing time is so much more efficient in comparison to a lesser processor due to time saved. Now, I do have a confession. I'm a new Ryzen adopter and still learning as much as I can. This is where I would love to get you, the community, more involved with any knowledge and experience you may have to share. I'm happy to be the guinea pig for suggestions if you have them. AMD Ryzen processors perform better when paired with higher frequency and lower timed RAM, leading to increases in performance. Second gen Ryzen also has a few tricks up its sleeve in the form of XFR2 and Performance Boost 2. From my own research and tests, it does seem as though the 2700X is optimized in such a way that overclocking is actually not worth it and quickly hits the point of diminishing returns. When tweaking the BIOS or Ryzen Master Program, it was fun to then launch a synthetic benchmark such as Cinebench and achieve a high score. However, it simply isn't worth the negative hit this system takes. If you're new to Ryzen or simply have never used a Ryzen CPU, there are a few things that stood out to me. First of all, as everyone knows, the price to performance is unmatched. Additionally, the 2700X comes with a cooler, the Wraith Prism, but personally I find it a bit noisy and somewhat average at cooling, especially for intense workloads. An included cooler in the price is fantastic, but you'll probably pick up an aftermarket cooler down the road. My first concern came from the core voltage. The 2700X on default out of the box settings runs at a core voltage which most users aren't used to. You can expect to see numbers typically between 1.3 to 1.45 volts, and when left free will jump around as and when it needs to. This is completely normal behavior for this processor and has actually been designed that way. Due to the way XFR works, also known as extended frequency range, Ryzen CPUs reward you with extra performance when you provide the CPU with both sufficient cooling and power, more cooling than the Wraith Prism provides in my opinion. Second to that, my personal issue involves my PC case. It is infamous for bad thermals. The base clock frequency of the 2700X is 3.7 GHz with a boost of 4.3 GHz, and most users don't seem to push it much further when overclocking, changing the base to a constant 4.3. The issue with a locked 4.3 is that it will require a high core voltage. This in turn results in increased CPU temperatures, which when not cooled properly can go above the recommended maximum limit of 85 degrees Celsius as outlined by AMD. So my personal preference after playing with overclocking is actually to leave everything on auto. It's more stable, more reliable, and provides lower temps. Connecting this back to RPCS3, the emulator will suck up as much raw clock speed combined with good instructions per cycle as you can throw at it, hence why an 8700K can edge out in the FPS arena. Raising the base clock of the 2700X will increase FPS in RPCS3 slightly if it is something you truly want to do. Based on tech industry tests clock for clock between the two processors, the difference is almost non-existent when tested at the same frequency. And with the higher thread 2700X, it naturally smashes the 8700K on multi-threaded tasks. This is to be expected, of course, given that the AMD CPU is 8-core 16-thread versus the 6-core 12-threads of the Intel. Long story short, we could discuss every detail of the processors in depth, but for now, my understanding is that Ryzen is intelligently designed so that it performs optimally when allowed to control itself due to the technology within it. Pair the processor with quality memory and cooling, and you've created the perfect environment for the CPU to thrive. To quote Robert Hillcock, Senior Technical Marketing Manager at AMD, on the topic of core voltages, "The CPU is programmed to use these voltages automatically. We know it's safe because we designed it that way. The CPU cannot and does not use voltages that are unsafe for the silicon. The key thing that people forget in these cases is time and temperature. Running 1.4 volts or 1.5 volts here and there is not a big deal because the CPU will eventually back down according to its pre-programmed model. Or if you have great cooling that also offsets the thermal effect of voltage. In either case, you're seeing momentary blips of voltage that are offset by the hours per day your CPU is probably doing nothing at all at a very low voltage. The average V-core for Ryzen over time is around 1.25 volts, give or take. TLDR, leave the CPU alone, let it do its thing, don't worry. We designed the CPU to do this." So that's it for now, people. My two cents on the 2700X and how it behaves in RPCS3. Hopefully you've learned a little something. Future videos will cover FPS and performance numbers across a whole host of titles, so remember to make any requests you may have. For those of you more seasoned with Ryzen, feel free to drop any knowledge that you think will be useful in the discussion. Leave your ideas, thoughts, and comments down below. I read all of them. If you disliked the content, dislike. If you liked it, leave a like. And to stay up to date with all things emulation, subscribe and hit that bell icon. I'll catch you in the next one.